And that's a great place to start. And if you've not started there before today, I hope before this day is over, you'll get your start in loving Jesus Christ. But thanks for being here. Man, what a rainstorm last night, huh? Woo! I was thinking Miracle March last night. Some of you have been around for about 35, 40 years. Remember the Miracle March we had, another big drought, and looked like we were heading for a horrible summer, and all of a sudden the clouds opened up and the skies burst, and man, we never talked about drought for another 20 years after that one. So just maybe we'll get another March. But it was great last night. The good news is, it's not going to start raining until about 8 or 9 o'clock again tonight. That means clear skies for the pie auction, all right? That is good. That is good news. I'll talk a little bit more about that in just a moment. But welcome to New Hope Church. It's great to have you with us today. If you are a first-time guest, we are honored by your willingness to choose New Hope as a place to check out. There is a card, a communication card in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to grab it, fill it out, drop it in the offering when it comes by. We make a promise. We're not going to harass you on the phone or beat on your door, but through the mail, send you some information of what goes on around here. It gives you an idea of what we believe, and hopefully answer most of your questions, and if it doesn't, let us know, and we'll annoy you and try to answer your questions, but we'd love for you to fill that out and drop it in if you would, please. This afternoon, right after our last service today, the 10:45 service, somewhere around 12:15, our homeless ministry will gather and prepare and launch off our church property to minister to others today, and you can join them over in the JAMS building in the surf room, all right? So that's the building out in front, the back corner room. Go over there and check it out and find out what they're going to be up to today. This evening, 6 o'clock, if you are bringing a dessert or an auction item, it would be terrific if you could have it here by 5:30. I know that means you get here a little early for the event, but it takes our high school team a little bit of time to get your dessert or your main course or your special auction item tagged and on the list and out on display so that folks can walk by and see it and decide what it is they're going to bid on. If you are new to New Hope Church, you've never been to a pie auction, I would love for you to come, even just come for half an hour. This takes us usually about an hour and a half, okay, to do. There is nothing worshipful about what we do tonight, okay? The sanctuary becomes transformed into an auction site, all right? It's for a wonderful cause, all right? This is for our high school Mexico mission trip that will take place between Palm Sunday and Easter Sunday. We've been doing this. I believe this is going to be our 20th year for a pie auction, all right? So I think this is year number 20. But this is year number one for our youth pastor. Okay, Chris has never been to a pie auction here before, and I think he doubts what gets accomplished here. I think he's a little bit nervous, all right, about, I mean, can we really raise that much money tonight? So we need to teach him tonight, all right? So I hope you have plans of going home and making your best dessert, okay, and or main dish, bring it back tonight, and we will auction it off. I always give a few disclaimers. Guys, there are a few things that you will be able to buy at the, I got to be honest, there is not one good deal at the pie auction tonight, okay? This is not a value-driven thing like a lot of times you do, all right? There will be a few things that will go for $25 or $30. Most of the things are going to go $50, $75, $100, and there will be some things that will go for $600, $700, $800, okay? I'm just telling you. So I don't want you to get discouraged if you're coming here thinking I'm going to take home a really great dessert. You might. You might not, all right? That's not the goal. The goal tonight is this is the primary funding for for the construction on the Mexico mission trip. The whole project to transport 50 to 60 kids with adult leaders, the transportation, the lodging, the food, and then the building supplies. We are building a house in 4 days. Okay, we will build a house in 4 days. It's been done before. It'll be done again. And so to buy all of those supplies usually runs between $20,000 and $27,000. Okay, and so the kids have sent out letters for sponsorship, and then this is our church's primary thrust. And this is usually, well, last year it was $17,000. This was two-thirds of what was necessary. And so We hope you plan, go home, bake something, take a nap, come back, and bring your checkbooks with you. And we want to try to beat last year's. If we know God will supply. He always does. We never know what's going to show up. Here's what I do know will be here. Ron Robinson, who does not attend our church, but I met him at a Clovis High baseball auction. Okay? And for the last 3 years, he's called 2 or 3 weeks in advance and said, can I bring something this year? So he is bringing, I know, 2 homemade apple pies, and he is bringing a homemade peach cobbler. Yeah, I do that. Yeah. He asked me, he said, Tim, would a cobbler work? I said, oh, yeah. I said, and then I said, may I put an order in? Peach goes best, okay? And so he's bringing that tonight. Dad had said he's not doing any more chicken and dumplings. But he's relented one more time. This will be his last year. This will be his last year. And I think I had this idea in the last service. I think we're going to do 2 things connected to chicken and dumplings. We will do 1 chicken and dumplings dinner, and then, since this will be his last year, we will auction off instruction. If you want to show up at Pop's house and have him teach you how to do it and assist him, we will sell off the privilege of learning how to make Grandma McLean's chicken and dumplings, all right? Because that's the recipe that he uses. So that will be tonight. There'll be a Bite Me Barbecue. He's got some more barbecues that are going to be out there. And that's always wonderful at graduation time because they'll take care of 50 to 60. Let's see here. Oh, the rocking chair. I think we got a picture of it. This is going to be auctioned off. This comes from the prison, all right, in Angola. All right, this was made by the inmates there. It was assembled by Deacon Dave at our church, and it's been stained by Glenn Mattson. All right, and so that is an incredible piece of craftsmanship there. That is, trust me, that is not a flimsy rocking chair. That will stand the test of time at your house. And so that's a contribution that's being auctioned off tonight as well. So we hope to have you back. That's enough about that. I hope you'll come join us. If you can't stay for the whole time, bring your checkbook. 30 minutes, we can get enough out of you. You can leave. All right? If you're a guest, please don't take offense to that. We have a lot of fun doing it, and it's all for a very, very great, wonderful cause. It's mission outreach. There's a sign-up sheet that's coming around, and it has 1 event on it, but there's 2 separate forms that you can volunteer on. The Wednesday night preceding Easter, we're doing a new kind of family event. Often our youth department puts on some kind of Easter egg hunt or something like that for our kids. This year, it's going to have a little bit more thrust to it. As you'll notice on here, and you've got an insert in your bulletin, it's called The Road to the Resurrection. Our Jam Center, our recent remodeled kids center, is going to be transformed into a walking journey through the Holy Land. You are going to enter, and when you enter that building over there, you are going to walk into. You'll notice it on your insert. You're going to walk in to Jerusalem, all right? The last city that Jesus was in before his crucifixion. You're then going to walk into a room that's the upper room where the Last Supper took place. You're going to be treated to an event that took place very similar to what Jesus did. You're going to then get to go to a prison cell. I believe it's the prison cell of Barabbas, okay, who Pilate offered to set to really crucify in place of Jesus. You're then going to be taken to the place of the crucifixion, and then you will end up at the empty tomb. So this is a walking journey with lessons and stories being told and acting being done. And this for you to go through it, I think, is less than an hour. Okay, this will be going on from 5 to 7:30, so you all don't have to show up at once. You can come, but anybody who shows up after 7:30, you don't get the tour. Okay, those who show up by 7:30, you'll get the tour, and it will be over close to 8:30, okay? So it's one of those you can come, go, come, do, and leave. Does that make sense? All right, there's a couple of ways in which you can help, and when they shared this with me last week, I was so excited. I am I'm all in on this, and I hope you will be too. This is something grandparents, you can bring your grandkids, parents, you can bring your kids and your parents. This can be a family event as you take this journey through the Holy Land in the last days of Jesus' life, and there's 2 ways you can help. The top 2 pages are items to help pull off all the decorating and all the stuff that needs to be done in each room. So you can help with some of those supplies. The last two pages, which are on this sign-up sheet, is if you would personally like to volunteer for that night. And volunteering for that night, there are some very simple things. You can be a greeter. Introduce as families show up. You can greet them at the front door, explain to them what's about to happen, and point the direction. You can lead a station in one of those rooms. You can be a leader in that room and lead the activity. You can work in food prep serving because there's going to be refreshments in one of those rooms. You can be like a tour guide and lead a family from room to room to room. All right? Or you can be an actor in one of the rooms portraying the characters that will be portrayed in that story on the road to resurrection. So if you can help in any of those areas, please sign up. Okay, so those sign-up sheets are coming around. What a wonderful, Eric Olson, stand up. What a wonderful CR celebration we had last Thursday night. Okay. So we celebrated 7 years of ministry. I'm already thinking about eight. Celebrated 7 years of Celebrate Recovery. And guys, I'm going to tell you, there were some absolutely incredible testimonies that were shared last Thursday evening here. I want to say thank you. We had four or five small groups who made that their event that week, and you came that night. Thank you. We had about 105 to 110 folks join us that night for the Celebrate Recovery. Wonderful food. We had plenty to eat, and then a wonderful time in here with some worship and testimonies. So, Eric, thank you for putting it all together. I'm going to come back to God's Not Dead. I already talked about the pie auction. If you have accepted Christ over the last several months or even over the last several years, but you've never been baptized and would like to be, take one of the communication cards in the pew in front of you, fill it out, check baptism, and we'll send you some information in the mail and then call you and we'll set a date for doing those baptisms. Senior luncheon is this Tuesday. Prime timers, all right? Prime timers, 55 or older. Come and hang out with Steve Brown, and got a special guest. We had inserts in your bulletin last week, who goes around and visits people in the hospital, and she takes her four-legged creatures with her, and it's wonderful therapy for the patient. So you're going to hear a lot more about that. Please read all the other things that are in your bulletin. Let me highlight a couple of prayer requests, and then I'll talk about God's Not Dead, and we'll have our offering, and we'll see a clip of the God's Not Dead 2 movie. Jo Newby, she's been at New Hope longer than I have. She's been at New Hope since the original conception of New Hope Church, and she is leaving us in about 10 days. She's going to be going to Ohio. She's moving there with her daughter and her daughter's family, and I've known Jo Newby almost 50 years. She was good friends of the Glazebrooks. I met her when I was about 10 or 11 years old, and her hair was red. Now it's white. I probably contribute to a couple of those, but anyway, she was a little nostalgic this morning, very excited a few weeks ago. Now she's starting to realize, whoa, I'm not going to be at the place that's been home for half a century. So be praying for Jo. If you know her, give her a call. I have not received an update about Brandy. She's due back home from her trip to Boston, getting treated for the large tumor in her eye. Aina Johnson, this will be a name that some of you will recognize if you've been in church at New Hope for quite a while. Aina's been at Willow Creek for about 14 years. But she and her husband were part of our church, and we did her husband's memorial service here. Got a call that things were not well. Dad visited Aina frequently. Gene visited Aina frequently. I visited her on occasions and tried to make it there every Christmas. The last couple of years, we didn't get there near as often because she no longer remembered any of us. Didn't remember her family anymore. But we always tried on special occasions to get by. So I went by Thursday after I got a call saying things were getting tenuous. I walked in, and she was bright-eyed, and she said, "Who are you?" And I introduced myself again. She said, "Well, thank you for coming by." And we chatted a few minutes. And I asked if I could, I first pointed to the picture above her head, which is a picture of her husband. And I said, "You married a good man." She said, "The best." And I said, "Well, he married pretty good too." She said, "He married the best." Her sense of humor was always good. I asked if I could pray with her. She said, "On one condition." I said, "What's that?" She said, "I can pray for you." I said, "Okay." So we prayed together. We held hands. We prayed together. And then I kissed her on the forehead. And she looked up at me with a big smile, and she said, "You can do that anytime you want to." And so I had a great, precious visit with her. I went back Saturday morning, and during the night before, Aina went home to be with the Lord. So in a couple of weeks, for those of you who know her, we'll keep you posted. In a couple of weeks, there's going to be a reception done at Willow Creek for Ana. But thought I should let you know that. And then some of you know Mark and Lynn Lewis from around here. They were in the church 25 years ago when we merged, and they've moved away. But Lynn's parents were here. We did her dad's funeral 18 months ago. Her dad was an anesthesiologist, found Christ just a year before he died. His wife never had accepted the Lord, and got a call from Lynn that her mom had taken a rapid decline. She's at San Joaquin, had a beautiful apartment there, but she had declined. She was under 24-hour care now. I walked in to see her, and I said, "Jean, how are you?" She said, "I'm not good." I said, "What's going on?" She said, "I'm dying, and I have no hope." And I was able to ask her, I said, "Are you scared of dying, or are you scared because you have no hope?" And she said, "Both." You know what that does to a pastor? You just open the door nice and wide. All right, you've invited me in. And I said, "You know what, Gene, I can't help you with the fact that you're dying, because I am too. But what I can help you with is the hope." And I said, "And the reason I can help you is because Christ has given us the answer to hope." We looked at a few scriptures, talked with her a few minutes about it, and then I said, "Jean, is there any reason you can't pray right now?" And she said, "Yeah, I'm scared." I said, "Are you scared of praying or scared of dying?" And she said, "Scared of dying." I said, "Then is there a reason why we can't pray right now?" And she said, "No," and she reached out and grabbed my hands, and she is not weak yet. She nearly pinched my fingers off, all right? And she prayed, and she invited Christ in her life, and I was able to call Lynn, who hadn't got to town yet, and say, "Lynn, your mom just accepted Christ." And she got to town later that night. I was able to get back the next day and visit with all three of them. And Jean remembers exactly what she did the night before. I said, "Jean, how was that?" And she said, "You got to understand, Jean, she's a little stoic, a little controlled." And she said, "That was different." And I said, "Yes." But I said, "Do you have hope today?" She said, "Yes, I do." Amen. Amen. So that's great rejoicing. So do be praying for them. Those are the updates I wanted to share with you. One more handed to me. Mariah Funk, and I'm told some of you in this room will know Mariah Funk. You'll know her because of Janet Haney. She was at the home, the what do you call it, the girls? New Life for Girls. Did really well, had done well for a few years, went back to an old boyfriend, and she spiraled downward. She's now in the hospital, her kidneys are failing, and Janet is with her this morning at the hospital. So if you'd remember Mariah, they would appreciate that. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we pray. For our offertory, you're going to see a film clip from God's Not Dead 2. We have, you'll see it in the bulletin, there's a date reserved for our church. We have the whole theater. We have one of the theaters at Maya, and you can pick your tickets up out in the pavilion today. They're $8. It's a great movie, I think, you can bring a guest to, and we'll have a wonderful time together on April the 2nd. Oh, and by the way, I was told last service, there's a March date on the sign-up sheet going around, but in the bulletin for Road to Resurrection, it says April. April is not correct. It is March. Easter is in March this year, all right? So the day is correct, just the month is in error, all right? Let's pray. Father, for the beauty of this day, for the freshness because of the recent rain, we simply say thanks as you have cleansed the air and you have added more water to the soil and more snow in the mountains. We are so grateful for today's provisions that have tomorrow's needs in mind. And Father, what you do for this earth, you also do for us. When Jesus Christ becomes our shepherd Savior, it meets our needs to today, and it provides us for our concerns about tomorrow. When we face death, we don't have to be hopeless. When we face dark valleys of other kinds, we do not have to be afraid. Father, you know the purpose that each of us are here today. We may have come for one reason, but you may have had another reason. That's why your scripture says you work all things together for good if we will love you. And I trust decisions will be made today to love you more, to love you best. Thank you for the privilege of giving and sharing. Father, we trust you with the concerns that we've expressed, those of a physical nature, those of a spiritual nature, those, Father, even for tonight, of a financial nature. We trust you for all those. And we do this in the incredible name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Thank you for singing that today, Milo. Is that not a great song? Man, if you've not sung it before, oh. And let me tell you, what a song. What a song to hear and to learn for the very first time in a village in Africa. It made me cry, Jerry. Let me tell you, we sat under that tent the first morning that we sang, and it was the first morning we were there, first morning I preached this year. And we're sitting there underneath that tent, about 130 strong, 60 who had come from the United States, and another 50 or 60 of our Ivorian friends from Ivory Coast of Africa. And to realize gathered on the continent of Africa were both Americans and Ivorians. And to realize that barely 200 years ago it was the Americans capturing many of the Ivorians and bringing them back to this country to be slaves. And yet that day together we sang, none of us are any longer slaves to fear. But together we are now children of God. It was good, man. It was good. I look forward to one of these days, a few of our Ivorian friends getting to come to California and to come be able to share with you as a few of us get to go and share with them. Your hearts would just be incredibly blessed. There's a group of about 15 to 20 young men and women. They are in their mid-20s to their early 30s, and they are on fire with the love of God in them. And they are in the universities. They are teaching school. They are working in government offices. They really believe that God can transform their country, and they're excited about it. Well, I invite you to turn to Psalm 23. We're in the midst of a series. If you're new today, we are preaching through the Psalms this entire year of 2016. It started after our first Sunday when we looked at the idea of a less, more lifestyle. At the beginning of a year, we often think of less weight, more shape. We think of less debt, more savings. We think of a lot of things that have to do with less and more. And we were challenged in that first week to think about, how does this fit spiritually? How does this deal in our walk with Christ? And John the Baptist is the one who was the standard bearer for this idea of less and more lifestyle. When Jesus came on the scene, John the Baptist said, I must decrease, and he must increase. And Paul the Apostle picked up that banner and waved it strongly throughout his writings, from the book of Romans, all right, all the way through Philippians and Galatians and Ephesians. And particularly in Galatians, he said, I am crucified with Christ, so that it's not I who directs my life, but it's Christ who lives in me. And so I ask you to think, and I gave you all a slip of paper those first couple of weeks, and I gave you a two blanks to fill in. Less what, more what in 2016. And I tossed out a few suggestions, but I ask you to be praying. What would God want you in your life to have less of this, that's your normal personality, and have more of this, which is the life of Christ? The song, less fear, more courage, less doubt, more trust. Less anxiety, more contentment. I don't know what your answer is, but I ask you, write it down, put that in your Bible, because in December, I'm going to ask you to pull those slips of paper out again. And if you weren't here that day, it's not too late. Just get a tithing envelope, all right? And write on it, less, more, and write out a few things and tuck it in your Bible. And we're going to see how we're doing. We get to the end of the year and see what that benchmark looks like. I shared with you then the following week that there are four steps to this process of a less, more lifestyle. It doesn't happen by accident. It doesn't happen by chance. So what was the first step of a less, more lifestyle? Choice. Starts with a choice. You don't lose weight without thinking about it. You don't get a larger savings account without thinking about it. You don't pay off debts without thinking about it. There must be a choice. Once we make the choice, what's the second step? Consistent. The left side's doing really good. Right side, you're a little weak right now, all right? You need to pick up the pace over here just a bit. Choice, consistency. Yeah, it's not a once and done choice. This is a choice I must make consistently. Really, Paul said it this way. I do it every day. Paul said, I die daily to self so that Christ is alive in me. So choice, consistency. Third step in this process is? Account. Oh, way to go, right side. All right, good job. Yeah, it must be accountability. All right. To really maintain consistently, we need to have some type of accountability. And so, you know, if you're married, ask your spouse. If you got, hey, here's the big one. If you're a parent, you have a tendency to get angry pretty easy. Ask your kids to hold you accountable. Less anger, more patience. Okay, they're gonna know that one better than anybody else. All right, I realize that's dangerous ground. All right, because they're gonna say less, more, mom, dad. you're not getting in very good shape, dad. But you know, accountability is so critical. And then the last step is the one that's pretty foreign to 21st century thinking. It is contemplation, the slow, steady, quiet thinking about God and His Word. So, this is a drive-through window society that we have now. This is a Johnny Quick, stop and go, okay? And the emphasis is on the go, all right? Stop, go! And no, God says stop, be still, and know that I am God. And so we chose the book of Psalms. Why? Not because choice and consistency and accountability is not important, but those are easier for us to learn. What's hard for us to learn is meditation. And the hymn book of God, which is the book of Psalms in the Old Testament, it's the songs that God recorded. We tend to remember songs more than we do quotes. Okay? Songs tend to come to our mind. You guys are going to start, I bet you this week, though you just heard it for the first time, but you might not even remember all the words, but all of a sudden, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child, God. That's gonna start ringing in your head this week. And I hope we sing it. I hope we sing it again next week. Okay. And as soon as that gets in your head, all right, God's gonna use that. What can melodies come to our mind? God knew that, and that's why He put His hymn book. Biggest book in the Bible is His hymn book. And the hymn book teaches us more than any other book in the Bible how to meditate and contemplate. Last week, as we looked at the 23rd Psalm, we've made it. We're not going. We're trying to kind of stay in order, but we might jump around just a little bit. We can't do every Psalm because there's 150 Psalms, but we're going to be covering 40 to 45 of them. But Psalm 23, though it's small, is so power-packed that we've had to settle here for a few weeks. Last week, and if you've missed other services and would like to kind of get caught up, you can always go to the church website and you can listen to the previous sermon since the beginning of the year, if you would like to do that. If you are not internet savvy and you would like CDs, you can call the office and they will provide those for you as well. Last week, as we really looked at the opening line of Psalm 2, is it warm in here to anybody else? Just me? Okay, make sure the heaters are turned off over here. I already turned them off over here, and I shall do this. Okay, this works out really good. Okay, here we go. I wish my shoulders were that wide, all right? That's Steve Smith in the 8 o'clock service, all right? If any of you have high school girls going to Mexico Mission, they're going to drool all week. I just tell you, okay? I just tell you, it happens every year when Steve goes on the mission trip. He's like 6'4". He's like... He's not in here. I didn't do this in the 8 o'clock service. Yeah, don't tell him. But his shoulders are this wide. His hips are this narrow. His arms are like this, okay? And he's so nice, okay, that, yeah, everybody just melts. You know what? I wished I was a girl. he's a hunk, man. He is. I'm just saying. Can I say anything wrong? Did I lie at all? No, okay. Yeah, get back to the message. Yeah, I'm making all the rest of the men a little mad in here. All right, sorry, guys. But David, David, in the opening line of Psalm 23 last week, the first thing David does is he refers to God as Lord, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. You'll see it that way, all right? And the reason is because this was personal with David. He used the term Yahweh, all right? This is the four consonants in Hebrew. There was no vowel put in this. And it was always a capital Y, capital H, capital W, capital H when it was translated into our English language because it was emphasized that way from the Hebrew.
again, I'm repeating myself for some of you, but this was such a precious, valuable, important, sacred word to the Jews at that time that the scribes would wash their hands before they wrote that word in Hebrew. And the instrument they used to write that word with, they would destroy it once they had written it once, and then they would wash their hands again. That is how valuable this word was to them. And David declares Yahweh as his Lord. And then last week we looked at the fact that David called Yahweh the Lord. He also called him my shepherd. See, to David, he considered himself one of the sheep, that God was his personal shepherd, not merely a shepherd of a great flock of all humanity, but that the shepherd who was the Lord knows David by name and cares for him personally. And the way we ended last Sunday's sermon was I asked you to fill in the blank of two sentences. I'm not asking you to complete the scripture, though the blanks I'm asking you to fill in are from scripture. I'm not wanting the scriptural answer. I'm wanting you to deal with the personal answer. And I ask you to fill in the blank to this sentence personally. Not the way David did. How it would be true for you. The Lord is my blank. But who is he really to you? Is Yahweh God, the one who always has been and always will be? This God who has no beginning and this God who has no end. This God who is the creator, not the created. This God who said, I am that I am. Who is he really to you? To some folks, he's a safety net. He's there to catch them if they're ever in trouble. You know, if they can walk the line themselves, no problem. But if they happen to slip and fall, here's a safety net for them. For some, God is a Santa Claus. We only go to him when we want something. We climb up in his lap and say, oh, Santa Lord, I need, I want. Sometimes we use him for an escape clause. For when I die. What occurred to me this week there, I think there's a lot of people who it's not that they use them for an escape clause because they're really thoughtful about going to heaven when they die. They just don't want to go to hell when they die. And so we treat them like an escape clause. Really, I bet a lot of folks, I think that if they thought they were just dead and buried, food for worms, that they would be okay with that. But they don't want to go to a place called hell. Is that who he is to you? For some, he's nothing. You never consider him in the adventure of a week. Your day doesn't start thinking about him. You sit down to a meal. You don't even think about grace. You've got a problem in the family. Your kids are messing up. You never look to the scriptures to say, God, do you have something to say about this screw-up son of mine? You never turn to the scriptures to see what it says about your marital relationship. You don't seek the ethics of the scripture for the business decisions that you make. And if that's you, then be honest. Write nothing. The Lord, this Yahweh God, that doesn't change who he is, but who is he to you? The second sentence I asked you to fill in was the same sentence, but the blank's in a different place. The blank is my shepherd. See, somebody is leading you. Somebody is helping you call the shots for your attitudes, your actions, your behaviors, and your beliefs. Who's doing that for you? And maybe it's you. Then write in. If this were me, write it in that way. I would say, Tim is my shepherd. I am my all in all. I am the one who handles everything, and I can and will handle everything in my life. Write your name in then if you are your shepherd. For some, it's your spouse. You don't make a move without them. You consult them about everything, but you never consult God. For some of you, as you've gotten older, your kids have become your shepherd. For some, it's your job, your bank account, your hobby. This brief song, these six verses of Psalm 23, which was composed by someone who became a king, but before he was king, he was a former shepherd. And this psalm has endured itself to people I've discovered in every circumstance of life. As I've read all kinds of articles and books and research and just talked to people about the 23rd Psalms, here's just a pinch, all right, of the myriad of times that Psalm 23 has made a difference in people's lives. The soldier in battle, fearing injury and possible death, quotes the 23rd Psalm. The grieving widow standing before a fresh grave, wondering how she's going to go on with the rest of her life, she quotes the 23rd Psalm. The guilty wanderer seeking forgiveness and direction turns to the 23rd Psalm. The suffering saint strapped to a bed of pain, the lonely stranger looking for love and companionship, the destitute and the forgotten, the depressed and the jobless, the prison inmate and the persecuted, the prodigal and the orphan, all find solace in the shepherd of the 23rd Psalm. And you know what's common about all those, whether it's the soldier or the widow, the guilty or the suffering, the incarcerated or the persecuted? Do you know what's common about all of them? They all have endured or trying to endure the daily grind of uncertainty in their life. What's tomorrow going to bring me? How's this going to end? And uncertainty can wear us down to the bone. When the trials of life push us to our very limits, when our hearts are the heaviest they can possibly be, the magnificent Psalm of the Shepherd, it offers to you and to me at every age, it offers comfort and assurance, especially for those who lack that sense of a feeling of security because God is always present. Do you have that locked in to your thinking and to your emotions? Have you locked in the reality that there is nowhere you can go that God is not with you? Have you locked that in, that there is no problem that you will ever face, that God is not in you right at that very moment? That whether it is sickness or death, whether it's Africa or Mexico or Fresno or Clovis. I mean, it's just given, right? God's in Clovis. I mean, we all know that, all right? Well, it doesn't make any difference where you are. God, that needs to get locked in. Because that's the key to all this. That's what the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd, that's all I want. Why? Because in everything else in my life falls into its proper place. Let's look at the analogy and allegory at the center of David's song. Psalm 23 is the victorious song of frightened sheep. As though considering its life with the shepherd and recording the experiences, the sheep writes the psalm. This is a biblical metaphor that has layer upon layer of significance. It's why we're spending a few weeks in it. Please understand, you realize David is a sheep talking about Jesus as a shepherd. This is not a psalm about real sheep and a real shepherd. Okay, you understand that, right? This is a biblical metaphor. It's a beautiful oil painting that hangs in the gallery of our minds to illustrate a real truth. We are obviously not animals with four hoofs. I saw all of you come in today upright, okay? You walked in here, all right, on two legs. Though some of you may be white-haired, I didn't see anybody covered in wool. When we open our mouths, I didn't hear anybody bleat. You all sang beautifully today. We speak, we talk, even if some of our words come out badly. Good. You guys were sharper than the 8 o'clock service. They were still sleeping. David wasn't saying that we were sheep. What David is saying is we are like sheep. In fact, another one of the biblical writers says it like this: all we like sheep have gone astray, Paul. All we like sheep have gone astray. It's the same principle that David is dealing with here. Consider some of the similarities between helpless sheep and God's children. And you're not going to like this, okay? If there's another animal out there in the world, that we could come up with dozens of other animals you would like to be like, the sheep. And yet, David in his own life said, no, this is pretty right on. You see, sheep kind of lack on their own a sense of direction. Unlike cats and dogs, sheep get lost very, very easily, even in a familiar environment of their own territory. Why? Because they eat with their eyes down. They look at the green grass, and as long as there's something green next to them, they can just keep wandering. If there's not something to herd them, they will just keep wandering away. They only see what's in front of them at the moment. Sound like anybody you know? See, we have a tough time guiding ourselves. That's why we need to rely on God's word for direction and the voice of our shepherd Savior. Number two, sheep are virtually defenseless. A lot of animals, even some of the smallest animals that I could think of, have some effective means of defense. They either have sharp claws or teeth or speed or an ability to hide or go into camo gear. They have a sharp sense of smell, of sight, and of hearing. They have great strength or they're fierce, but not sheep. Sheep are kind of awkward. They're really kind of weak animals. They're not real bright either. They have spindly legs. And they have tiny, tiny hooves, and they're really rather slow. They can't even growl. I mean, tell me how terrifying is. All right, it just doesn't work. They're rather defenseless. The only sure protection for sheep is the ever watchful shepherd, and so it is with believers. We are admonished by Paul in Ephesians 6:10. Be strong. How? In the Lord. In the Lord. Number three, sheep are easily frightened. Being not the brightest animal of creation, they are rather unimpressive in stature. They're aware of their weaknesses. Sheep find comfort in the shepherd's presence, including the reassuring songs he would sing at night. This is the culture of the time in which David wrote. David probably wrote many of his psalms while tending sheep, and he sang it to his sheep. Psalm 27:1 says, this is the type of shepherd-lord relationship that we have with God, a shepherd who sings to a sheep. Number four, sheep are by nature dirty. They can't help it. They're rather unclean. Their wool gets dirty really, really easily. Sounds kind of like of us, doesn't it? I'm not talking about your bathing practices. I'm talking about your spiritual practices. It's easy, isn't it? Other animals lick, scrape, and roll in the grass to cleanse themselves. Sheep don't do any of those things. They will remain filthy indefinitely until the shepherd cleanses them. And we too, by nature, are unclean and dirty. Apart from our tender shepherd's cleansing, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, talking to the church now, not talking to non-believers, talking to the church, if we as sheep confess our sins, he's faithful and just to do what? Bathe us really good. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Number five, sheep don't find food or water very well on their own. While most animals have a keen sense of smell, sheep don't. They depend upon their shepherd completely. If left to themselves, sheep will eat poisonous weeds and they will die. And when one eats a bad weed, others will follow it. I grew up in the 70s. I had some high school friends do the same thing. Smoke a little bad weed, others would go right along with them. All right? Again, as children of God, you and I are equally dependent upon our shepherd. Number six, the sheep's wool does not belong to the sheep. While sheep may produce wool, the shepherd owns the wool. All bona fide spiritual production in the life of any of us as Christians belongs to the Lord. It doesn't belong to us. The Lord, by means of the Holy Spirit, provides for all the production of the fruit of the Spirit in our lives. In every way we see, we are indeed His people, and we are the sheep of His pasture. Like many of the songs found in the Bible, Psalm 23 states its case in the first verse and simply verifies it in the remainder of the song. The key is this: because the Lord is my shepherd, I shall lack nothing. No uncertainty should frighten me. And here is the way Psalm 23 is played out in the balance of David's famous song. I shall not lack rest or provision. Why? Because he makes me lie down in green pastures. I shall not lack peace. Why? Because he takes me by still waters. I shall not lack restoration or encouragement when I faint, fall, or fail. Why? Because he restores my soul. I will not lack guidance or fellowship. Why? Because he guides me in the paths of righteousness. I will not lack courage when my way is dark. Why? Because even in the darkest valley, he is with me. I will not lack companionship. Why? Because he's always with me. I will not lack constant comfort. Why? Because his rod and his staff, they are there for me. I will not lack protection. Why? Because he prepares a table before me with my enemies checking me out. I shall not lack abundance. Why? Because my cup overflows. I shall not lack God's perpetual presence. Why? Because goodness and mercy follow me. How often? all the days of my life, and I will not lack security. Why? Because I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. If you've been here very long, you've heard this quote from Charles Haddon Spurgeon before, the Prince of Preachers. Charles Haddon Spurgeon says, "When I walk through the valley of the shadow of death and I die, I don't change residences. I simply climb the stairs and I enter the next level of God's forever home." If you and I are a child of God right now, if we are the sheep of His pasture, then right now we are already part of God's house. And when we die, there's nothing unfamiliar about where we're going. David establishes this theme in verse 1, and then the composer begins to develop this word picture of sheep and shepherd. He starts with a pastoral picture of sheep under a shepherd's care. Sheep are frequently alarmed and actually will run over each other, racing away from something that startles them. The shepherd corrects the problem by catching the sheep and gently yet firmly forcing them to lie down. He puts them in an environment where green grass is underneath their feet. And David remembers such occasions in his own life, and he writes, "He makes me sometimes to lie down." He makes me. In our hectic, hurried, harassed age in which headaches and tranquilizer medications have become the best-selling national products, sometimes our shepherd Savior makes us lie down. When He steps into our helter-skelter world, He most often will force us to rest. When that occurs, do you know what we should do? We should give thanks. We should give thanks, because where does He make us lie down? In green pastures. I got to be honest, I'm a product of my generation. It's tough for me to sit down. It's tough for me to be still. Apart from weariness, I don't like sitting still. I've been in and out of hospitals and hospice homes for 30-some-odd years. Except for a brief time when I was a senior in high school and I put my head through a window of a car, I've never spent time in a hospital for me till I was 60 years old, till last year. And since it was my head through the windshield, there really wasn't much concern over a problem, all right? And it's occurred to me, we sometimes probably should be slightly careful what we contemplate about. Because in recent years, leaving hospitals and hospice situations, I've often asked God, "God, if my roles were reversed and that was me in that hospital bed, if that was me in that hospice bed, how would You want to respond in me, and how would I let You respond in me?" I'll be honest, my few days in the hospital, I do not give me an A. Or a B, maybe a C. I might be optimistic. There's more I think God would like to have shown of Himself in those moments. Less of me, more of Him. He wants to teach us some things in those moments. And the first thing is to be grateful, because He forces us to rest in His green pastures. Verse 2 concludes with another pleasant picture. He leads beside quiet or still waters. Literally, it refers to waters that have been settled down. Mentally capture the peaceful scene. The sheep are tired and worn out from moving from one pasture to another. They need a long, refreshing drink from the rapid stream nearby. But sheep are instinctively afraid of rapids in the water. They think that if the water gets on their coats, they could become waterlogged and they can't swim very good. Have you ever seen a sheep swim? There's probably a reason for that. As a result, even though tired and hot from a blistering day, thirsty sheep will only stand and stare at fast-flowing streams but never drink. Uncertainty keeps them from needed refreshment. Sound like you? Uncertainty keeps you from needed refreshment. The shepherd leads them to quiet waters where they can drink without. He takes them just past where the rapids are, where the stream broadens out and it slows down. Guys, maybe that's new hope this morning for you. Monday through Saturday's been very fast-paced. Uncertainty. He slows the pace down a little bit for you in these hour and 15 minutes. And He gives us a chance to drink from His still, cool waters. Sounds a little bit like a beer commercial, doesn't it? So who's your shepherd? In whom do you place your trust? Who do you turn to for direction in times of uncertainty? Do you turn to a pastor, to a psychologist, to a close friend or a coach, a teacher or a small group leader? Just a quick thought. If you've considered any of those, any of us, have you considered that these people are merely sheep just like you? The one who we really need to go to is the one who is the shepherd of our soul. David understood the nature of sheep, including that we have a bad habit of wandering. Have you ever wandered off from God? Maybe you wandered in here because you've been wandering off from God. When one is attracted to a clump of grass away from the flock, off they go. Sometimes they're followed by a few other woolly wanderers, and soon night falls, and lurking in the darkness are hungry coyotes and wolves, four-legged savages looking for a supper of mutton. And the shepherd counts his sheep, and he calls them by name. And do you know what the New Testament says? When the shepherd counts to 99 and he's missing the 100th sheep, do you know what the shepherd does? He leaves the 99 in a secure fold, and he goes out and he looks for the wandering sheep. You see, verse 3 includes this line, "He restores my soul," because Psalm 23 is all about restoration. When I'm tired, I get restored by finding rest. When I'm thirsty, I get restored by finding refreshing drink. When I'm lost and I wander off, I'm restored. Why? Because I find my way back? No. Because the shepherd comes looking for me. The wanderer is restored by the shepherd himself. Are you a wanderer? Is wandering a habit with you? Why do you think you wander away from him so often? Let me wrap up three quick thoughts. Psalm 23, in these first couple of verses, this is a picture of provision. That when we trust the shepherd, and when we follow where the shepherd leads, when we're submissive to his leadership, our needs are met. Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need. There are supplies for my hunger and thirst, and they're referred to as green pastures and still waters. My shepherd has seen to it that everything I need has provided. Everything I need internally. Everything I need externally. Everything I need eternally, he has provided. Lie down in green pastures means that sheep have grazed until they're filled. Sheep don't eat lying down. They eat standing up. They lie down when they're full. Now, I understand. It's a little research. I've never witnessed personally. But I understand sheep eat full. They lie down. They start chewing their cud. What are they chewing? They're chewing what they already swallowed once. They're gifted with this ability to bring it back up. They chew it some more so they get everything out of it they possibly can. They swallow again. And then very contentedly, they burp. And nobody's offended. I'm not asking for you to start burping here, but here's what I want you to understand. This is a picture of the Word of God. When you and I take in God's Word, God gives us the ability by His Holy Spirit, He will bring back up to our remembrance. And we can allow the Word to do its work in us again. We'll apply it to our lives. And then we can experience the burp of contentment. Because we followed His leadership. Picture of provision. Martha Cook put it nicely in a 19th century hymn when she said, "In some way the Lord will provide. It might not be my way, and it might not be your way. And yet, in His own way, the Lord will provide." This is also not only a picture of provision, but it's also a picture of peace. Our minds are content. Sheep lie down when they feel secure, content, and at peace. When we are aware of the shepherd's presence, our minds relax, our anxious thoughts retreat into the presence of God, into His Word, and into His promises. And that knowledge imparts an attitude of quietness in our spirit. Isaiah said, "In quietness and confidence there shall be strength." Sounds a little like contemplation, doesn't it? In Job 34, it says, when he, God, gives quietness, who can make trouble? Isaiah in chapter 7 says, take heed and be quiet. Do not fear, be faint-hearted. And again, he says in chapter 32, the work of the righteous will be peace, and the effect of righteousness, quietness, and assurance forever. You and I, humanity, we tend towards coveting things. We have a hard time relaxing when there's things we want. We're prone to want what we don't have rather to enjoy what we do have. We're striving for more, straining for something else. We must learn sanctified ambition, that we seek God's perfect will and rest in God's perfect ways. And Philippians 3:11 says, I've learned, doesn't come naturally, I've learned that in whatever state, Oklahoma, Texas, Tennessee, California, whatever state, therewith I can be content. A little joke. Paul goes on to say, I can do all things through Christ who is my strength. Johnny, who was 5 years old, was in the kitchen with his mom. She was making dinner. And mom asked, Johnny, would you go into the cupboard? Would you get me out a can of tomato sauce? And Johnny said, Mom, it's dark in there and it scares me in there. And she said, Johnny, don't worry. There's nobody in there. And he said, but Mom, I don't know. He said, Johnny, Jesus is in there. It's okay. There's nothing to be afraid of. I says, okay. And he walks over and he opens the door to the cupboard and he looks in and it is just pitch dark in that cupboard. He's about ready to turn and leave and then he has an idea and he looks back inside and he says, okay, Jesus, if you're in there, hand me the tomato sauce. When you and I face dark moments in our life, Jesus is there. He really is. And then last, this is also a picture of personal nourishment. Our souls are fed from the Word of God. And this is also a picture of practical leadership. Notice the end of verse 3, he leads me into paths of righteousness. When you and I follow the shepherd, that's righteous. It's good. There was a song I learned as a kid in church. I found out it was written before any of us in this building were born, even my dad. It was written in 1903. George A. Young wrote it. Got a beautiful melody. I wished I could sing it for you, but all I can do is quote it to you. Some of you will know it. Some it'll be the very first time. Listen to these words. You'll realize he had been reading Psalm 23 when he wrote this song. In shady green pastures, so rich and so sweet, God leads his dear children along. Where the waters cool flow, bathes the weary one's feet, God leads his dear children along. And the chorus goes like this. Some through the waters, Moses and the children of Israel crossing the Jordan. Some through the waters. Some through the flood, Noah and his family. Some through the fire, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But all, you and me, through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song, and in the night season, all the day long. Next two verses go like this. Sometimes on the mount where the sun shines so bright, God leads his dear children along. Sometimes in the valley in the darkest of night, through sorrows, though sorrows befall us and evil oppose, though grace we can conquer defeats all our foes. Away from the mire and away from the clay, God leads his dear children along. Away up in glory, eternity's day, God leads his dear children along. When he leads and we follow, that is righteous. What brought you here today? Deep waters? Hot fire? Deep sorrow? I will suggest to you that God led you here today for a purpose, for a reason. And that reason was for you to fill in the blank in your life. The Lord is my, and the blank is my shepherd. If you can't honestly fill in the blank with shepherd and Lord, you can do that right now. You can pray what Jean prayed in her bedroom the other night. And you can have hope for a righteous journey for the rest of your days. If you have wandered away, You're here today because the shepherd somehow got you here. Because the shepherd always hunts down his wandering sheep. And you can wander no more. Let's pray. Our Father, you know the condition of each of our hearts. You hear the cry. Father, if we've put anything else in the blanks besides shepherd and Lord, then we are in need of praying today. We are in need of making a choice today. We need to make the choice in our heart that Joshua made for his family thousands of years ago when he said, As for me and for my house, we will serve the Lord. Father, that is a choice that we all must make. And from that choice, we can learn to be consistent and accountable and contemplative. And we can grow. Father, you have righteous paths for us to follow. You've given to us a biblical GPS system. You know where we are, and you know where you would like us to be. And you can lead us there. I trust we'll let you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Where do I expect to see all of you tonight? Pie auction.